Hello and welcome. I am Chakshu Roy and you're watching Laws in the Making on Rajya Sabha TV. Today on the show, we are discussing the Direct Tax Vivaad Se Vishwas Bill 2020. To discuss the bill, I have on the show with me Mr. Ved Jain, past president, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, and Mr. I.P. Bansal, former judicial member, Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. Currently, approximately Rs. 9 lakh crores are locked up in tax disputes. The finance minister in a 2020 budget speech proposed to bring a scheme to resolve pending tax disputes. 4 days later, she introduced the Direct Tax Vivaad Se Vishwas Bill in Lok Sabha. The bill establishes a resolution process by which income and corporate tax disputes can be settled.
Under the Vivaad Se Vishwas scheme, either the tax authority or the taxpayer with the pending appeal can file a declaration with a designated authority to start the dispute resolution process. The last date to file such a declaration will be notified by the central government. An officer not below the rank of a commissioner will be appointed as the designated authority to manage the scheme. The bill is applicable to income tax and corporate tax disputes pending before the commissioners, income tax appellate tribunals, or the higher judiciary.
Earlier, income tax laws were very rigorous. Now they are simplified. Most of the cases are old cases wherein department as well as individuals are involved in the litigation. This scheme is a good opportunity in the line of indirect tax scheme. Now, if this scheme is allowed by the designated authority, in that situation, there can be waiver from the interest, there can be waiver from the penalty. As per after issuance of the certificate, department cannot reopen similar cases or such cases. So it will have some sort of protection to the individuals. That's why it can be attractive for the individuals to opt for this scheme and avoid unnecessary litigation before the different authorities.
The designated authority will determine the amount that the appellant has to pay and grant a certificate within 15 days. The appellant will have 15 days from the date the certificate is issued to pay this amount. Appeals pending before the Commission and the Income Tax Appellate Tribunals will be deemed to be withdrawn when the certificate is issued. In the case of appeals pending before the Supreme Court and High Courts, the appellant will have to withdraw the appeal or petition.
There had been many cases of penny stock, bogus capital gain, cases relating to share capital, which is also bogus. So those cases have been there, and there the penalty and interest is also very heavy, and the amount of tax is also very high. So those were the also cases, and otherwise also there have been litigations every time. You always go for litigation, and once you go for litigation, it ends up to only Supreme Court. And so, for starting from a commissioner appeal, then you go to ITAT, you go to High Court. The pendency in ITAT as well as in commissioner appeal is very high. So this would keep on piling. They keep on piling. So that's why the reason was that so much of amount is due. It's not that the entire amount is due to the government. I can't say the entire amount is due to the government. Even the assessee may be having good points to win the case. So that's why he goes for appeal. Why should he go for appeal? He will go for appeal if he knows that he can win that case. Department, on the other hand, is duty bound at certain cases, although they have avoided certain cases where a threshold limit has been given, that if that case is up to a threshold limit, they don't go for appeal. This is the benefit which has been given.
During a budget speech, the finance minister pointed out that there are currently about 4,83,000 tax dispute cases pending in the different appellate forums. Mr. Jain, I wanted to start the program with you and ask you as to, you know, how does tax disputes occur in our system?
See, the answer is very simple. The taxpayer interprets the law, or taxpayer compute the tax liability according to his views, his assumptions, and the tax administrator or tax adjudicator decides the issue, the same issue, in a different manner, assuming it. So there is, over the period, the tax laws are quite complex. We will say the efforts are on to simplify it, but they're quite complex on that issue. So that leads to a tax dispute. It can start with one allowance or one deduction or exemption you have claimed. which the tax officer says you are not eligible to. You may have earned something which you say is not chargeable to tax. The tax officer may say, no, it is chargeable to tax. You may assume that this income is taxable at a one particular tax rate. The officer may say, no, the tax rate applicable will be a higher. Similarly, there can be a person which have earned income outside India. I say, I am a non-resident, I am not chargeable to tax on the income because earned outside India. You may say, no, I am, officer may say, no, you are, firstly, no, you are not a non-resident. Or he may say, you are a non-resident, but this income has accrued or arisen in India. Then when you computing profit and gains of business or professions, you have various sources of income. You have various expenditure which you have incurred. Under the law, particular income has to be computed in particular head. So we have five heads of income. And one is the salary income, which is simple. Then the income from house property, then business and gains of profession. Then you have a capital gain, and then you have income from other sources. In capital gain also, the issue arises is whether this is a long-term gain or it is a short-term gain. The tax rate on long-term is different, like tax rate on the short-term is different. Then there are disputes, which I believe there are many people who want to avoid taxes, so they do not declare the correct income, which the tax officer is able to get hold of it, and then the dispute starts. The person says no. Then there can be a dispute in which year this income is chargeable to tax. I say no, it is an income of 18-19. Officer says no, it is 17-18, you need to charge the income. Then there are expenses which you have incurred while earning income. You may claim deduction that this is the expenditure I have incurred for earning this income. Officer may say, no, this is not the expenditure. Or he may say this expenditure is not allowable under the provision of the Act. Or he may challenge the genuineness that this expenditure you don't have. Then there can be dispute about the books of account you have maintained. Then there can be other various allowances, deductions which you have claimed on that basis. So that these are the area which the dispute arises over a period. And when this dispute arises, then obviously there are certain other provisions under which when this dispute arises, some penalty is leviable. So once you are in dispute with your income, obviously then penalty also follows. Of course, interest is in between, then penalty is also leviable. Then on penalty also dispute arises. One says, no, I have disclosed my income, I have disclosed all my facts. There can always be a dispute between my interpretation and your interpretation, why there should be a penalty only. And he said, no, it is not there. Then under the income tax law, there are certain transactions which are prohibited or there are ceilings that you cannot do. As you cannot accept a loan or give a loan more than 20,000 rupees in cash. You cannot carry out a transaction of more than 2 lakh rupees in cash. There are these transactions. So for this, there are various provisions where penalty is leviable.
So what you're saying is differences in interpretation of law, differences in whether you have complied with the law, can end up in a dispute before tax authorities. Mr. Bansal, which brings me to you. You have extensive experience in looking at some of those disputes. What is the journey of a dispute? When I disagree with the tax authority or the tax authority disagrees with me, how does it begin and what is the journey that it follows in the entire life cycle?
So income tax, in an income tax act, there is an elaborate process for resolving a dispute. First, you have to file an appeal before CIT appeal, and thereafter the appeal can be filed by the department as well and by the SSE as well before ITAT, and then further appeal to High Court and Supreme Court. All these question of law, finding of fact is complete before tribunal.
Okay, so what you're saying is that the process has two parts. One part is within the framework of the income tax department or the income tax law. And the next part is where it goes out of that framework and extends to the judiciary. Is that
judiciary?
The, yeah.
So income tax tribunal, though, is an appellate authority under the Income Tax Act only. So any dispute, whether it is by the department or by the SSE, both have to travel through only appellate tribunal.
Okay.
So I am giving you some background. Why it is necessary to resolve this dispute? The government's efforts are always that these should be resolved within a short span of time, so that they have brought various schemes. First, they have brought the scheme of low tax effect cases. They have increased the amount to a very great extent, so to reduce the burden of the judiciary, income tax tribunal, CIT appeal, and all these things. So they have brought all these schemes of low tax effect.
Can you elaborate on that a little more?
Yes. Earlier the tax effect was very low, and then to the extent SSE has won the appeal, to the extent, if tax effect is below 50 lakh, then it further appeal will not be filed by the department.
Okay.
And then similarly, if tax effect is appeal is decided by the tribunal, if tax effect is more than less than one crore, department will not go to the high court. And
okay. Similarly, so what you're saying is that depending on the quantum of amount that has to be paid, whether further appeals can be filed by the department or not,
it is also regulated. Huh? They okay. have been stopped. So another thing, this scheme which has been brought by the legislature in Lok Sabha introduced bill number 29. This scheme, though, this scheme has been brought into the statute just to decrease the pendency as well as to collect the revenue, okay. more and more revenue. As you have already told that 4,83,000 cases are pending in the courts. So they are burdensome for the judiciary as well as for the department, because everybody has to make the effort.
Correct.
So assessee is under constant pressure for the recovery of that amount. So to bring that level to an easy level, government has brought this scheme. And the now the target of rupees 2 lakh crore has been fixed by 31st March. I think that for that, government has some logic for that also.
Okay.
Because you see the earlier scheme for indirect taxes, it has come from Sabka Vikas scheme. So what was the amount there? 3.6 lakh was area in that locked up. So 6.3 crore locked up revenue was 1.83 lakh.
So and the finance minister pointed out that about 1,80,000
so
of those spaces.
So 17% they could recover by the fixed time,
okay.
31st December. So that goes to 16.71% of the outstanding demand. So in this, they are taking as 9 lakh crores, something like that. So they are taking 21%. So target is not unreasonable, we can say. That can be collected. But at the same time, something more is to be brought in the scheme so that...
And we'll discuss as to what that, yes. what that more can be. Mr. Jain, is this the first of its kind scheme that has been brought in with respect to direct taxes?
No, this is not for the first time, I believe. Over a period after almost every 5 years, this type of scheme comes up. And the whole objective is to declog the system of judicial system which is there. And the objective of this scheme is to settle the disputes and move forward. It's a win-win situation both for the tax department as well as the taxpayer. Tax department is able to raise the resources, collect revenue, which gets stuck up in the litigation. And that for taxpayer, it's a situation where he moves efficiently, get rid of the all dispute, and put more focus and energy on productivity and working, etc. So there have been various instances when this scheme has come up. And similar scheme was there earlier 4 years back, then when the scheme has come up, that all pending appeals which were on that particular date, when the earlier budget used to be presented on 28 February, so that was the cutoff date was fixed. So all those cases by that time could have been taken on that cases, somewhat on a similar line. But I will say that this time the scheme is a little bit more liberal and I think more taxpayer friendly. And the way the process has been adopted is apparently looks to be more easy, I will say. That's an advantage, yeah.
Okay. And we'll discuss more about the scheme. But right now it's time for us to head into a break. When we come back, we will discuss the cases in the scheme which will not be covered in the recent cabinet announcements on the bill. Welcome back. On the program today, we're discussing the Direct Tax Vivaad Vishwas Bill 2020. The bill follows the 2019 Sabka Vishwas scheme, which provided a similar mechanism for indirect tax disputes.
Those who opt in for the scheme must waive their rights to seek any remedy or claim in relation to that dispute under any law. At the same time, they are given certain immunities under the bill. Once a dispute is resolved, the designated authority cannot levy any interest or penalty and no appellate forum can make a decision in relation to the matter of dispute. Such matters cannot be reopened in any proceeding under any law. However, this would not apply if a false declaration was made or if the taxpayer seeks any claim or remedy.
See, in the scheme, there has to be give and take. When there is a dispute, we have to agree, yes, there is some contentious issue. Either the taxpayer will win or the tax department will win. There is a dispute. In order to settle that dispute, you have to come to a formula where it is a win-win for both. If it is a win-win for one side, the other side will not come forward. So that's why this scheme provides that in case where the taxpayer is a litigant, he is litigating on that issue, then he need to pay 100% of the tax. But in case where the department is litigating, the taxpayer has got a judgment in its favor, but the department is not accepting that judgment, there they say in order to attract the taxpayer, you please pay 50% of the tax. So that's a distinction which has been made. I believe this is one of the best distinction. So you attract that person. So if you are litigating, you pay me 100% of tax, I am ready to withdraw my litigation. In case you are, I am litigating, then I am ready to withdraw my litigation, you just pay 50%. So that's a scheme which works like this.
The Vivad Se Vishwas scheme proposed in the bill will not cover disputes in three cases. These include disputes where prosecution has been initiated before the declaration is filed, disputes which involve persons who have been convicted or are being prosecuted for offences under certain laws such as IPC, and disputes which involve undisclosed foreign income or assets.
Out of 98,000 crore, they have been able to recover 38,000 or 39,000 crore. That is because they had given discount on that also. But the large taxpayer have not gone. 92% taxpayer have gone for that scheme. But the 8% the amount due from them is more than 1 lakh crore. So they have not taken the benefit of this scheme. The small or medium taxpayers, they have taken the benefit of this scheme. And after taking the benefit of this scheme, the government is able to recover about 39,000 crore rupees out of the 80 or some odd amount. But that 8% are the multinationals or maybe the big clients. They have not gone for this appeal. We thought they will also come forward, but they have a strong case maybe, or they have strong lawyers with them though who can defend that case, and that's why they have not gone for this case.
On February 12th, the Cabinet announced proposed amendments to the bill. The amendments would expand the scope of the bill to include disputes pending in arbitration and before debt recovery tribunals. The bill will now cover revision disputes and search and seizure cases where the recovery is below rupees 5 crore.
Mr. Bansal, in your earlier remarks, one of the things that you mentioned was that the idea of this bill is to declog the system and also bring some finality to these disputes that have been pending for some time. How is the bill, you know, addressing that in a timely fashion?
This is a very good question. This bill has been brought down for recovering the amount which is stuck up in the appeals. So sometime taxpayer, what he can do? He is ready to pay the taxes, but enclosed interest and penalty, because the very earlier 2011, 2012, 2013 are subject to the reopening on the basis of some information. So if you are assessing that in 2019, so you see the, how much the interest will be factor of that, even double or triple the amount of the tax, and then penalties hanging upon. So sometime assessee is very inclined to pay the taxes, basic taxes, but he is not ready to pay all the interest liability and penalty. And penalty invites prosecution also. So thinking on all these lines, and something, this dispute will take 10 years, 12 years, 13 years to solve, because there are appeals pending in the tribunal for last 5-6 years. So every step of appeal will take its own time. So till that, government also will not be able to recover the amount. So it is beneficial to both the person, assessee as well as to government, to recover that amount in an immediate manner, so that amount can be utilized for the development of the country. So in that part, this scheme is very good for even for the government as well as for the taxpayer. So these two factors are very important.
Okay. Mr. Jain, Mr. Bansal pointed out the team, you know, the scheme is a win-win for not only the taxpayers but also for the government. What are the kind of disputes that the scheme is currently covering under the bill?
So, let me explain the basic contours of the scheme and to whom it is beneficial and what needs to be done. What is the proposed legislation is like to do. As we said, that there are 483,000 appeals which are pending at the various levels, and the quantum of tax is somewhere 8 lakh, 9 lakh crore plus. Now, all these appeals which are pending as on 31st January 2020, that is the cutoff date, they are eligible to file this declaration. Now, these appeals can be before the commissioner appeal, before tribunal, before high court, before supreme court. This covers writ petition also, because in sometimes you do not file an appeal and you have some contentious issue where you go on a writ, so you can file. Then there can be a dispute with the dispute resolution panel, which is another forum under the Income Tax Act. Then there are sometime cases where instead of filing an appeal, you file a revision petition before the commissioner for revision of the assessment which has taken place. So 31st January, the cutoff date, it should be pending. Once you fall in that category, you become eligible. Then there are certain category of people which have been excluded, as we were listening to it. But by and large, all cases have been included except foreign income, foreign bank account, or some narcotic, drug, etc. Prosecution cases are there. Such cases have been included, and up to 5 crore rupees of demand per assessment year. And all what you have to do is a file a declaration. And what is now your obligation? Obligation is, in case your dispute relates to any income, meaning thereby tax on your income, all you need to pay the tax on that disputed income, which is being called in the bill as a disputed tax. And the simple example of can be, a person has declared an income of 10 lakh rupees, the income tax officer has computed the income of 25 lakh rupees, and that on 15 lakh rupees, there is a difference, a dispute going on at maybe in commissioner level, first stage. So what you need to do is, compute tax on 25 lakh rupees, what is your tax, compute your tax on 10 lakh rupees, what is the difference that you just need to pay, whatever is the applicable rate for that year, nothing to worry. If you pay that, then consequential, no interest, because there may be interest for delayed payment, then no penalty, because you may have conceded, you may have cheated the department, no penalty, and no prosecution. So this is the simplest case. Then the second case can be in the same example, if you have a declared 10 lakh rupees and you were before the commissioner 25 lakh rupees, hypothetically, commissioner has given you a relief of say 5 lakh rupees. So now in the tribunal, department is in appeal on 5 lakh rupees and you are in appeal on 10 lakh rupees balance left out. The scheme has been simplified to say, on your 10 lakh rupees, you will compute the tax in the same manner which I have calculated. On 5 lakh rupees where you have won and the department is in appeal, you need to pay 50% of the tax. And again, you get a 50% concession. Still, you can settle out the dispute. Then there is no penalty, no interest, no prosecution. Now, take a case where there is no income dispute. Dispute is with reference to some levy of interest or levy of penalty only, or fee sometime. In that case, the scheme says you just need to pay 25% of that, nothing else. So, a person has been levied a penalty of 1 lakh rupees, there is no other dispute pending, he just need to pay 25,000 rupees, get rid of the prosecution, etc. In search and seizure cases, this amount has been increased a little bit. Now, when we say I gave 100% tax, in that case, you need to pay 125% of the tax. But in case you have won the appeal and against that you, then the 62.5%. In order to encourage taxpayer to pay this amount quickly and to settle the dispute, this scheme has been bifurcated into two parts. If you pay out before 31st March, this is the tax rate. But if you do not pay by 31st March, as is proposed to be, the scheme will be open till 30th June 2020, then you may be required to pay 10% extra. So in that case, as I give my example, instead of 100% tax, you will be required to pay 110% tax. Penalty, instead of 25%, you need to pay 30% of tax. And in such cases, 125% to 135%. That's a scheme which has been worked. And the procedure has also been very simplified. All you have to do is file a declaration form to the principal commissioner. Based on their declaration form, he will determine the amount that this is the tax payable by you. And then you pay the tax along with the challan and withdrawal of the appeal, you go there. Simplification complete. Procedure will be very simplified. Only challenge is the time lag which has been from, I believe the bill will get passed in the first week of March only, and thereafter the scheme goes on. That is a little challenge, otherwise the scheme will be very smooth. That's it.
Okay, so process has been laid out. Now the challenge is as to how much time will people have to to comply with the 31st deadline, which gives them a little more relief because they pay after the 31st, it's 10% more in some cases. Mr. Bansal, that now brings me to the question of the after the bill has been introduced, the cabinet has also proposed certain changes. Is there more that can be done to make, you know, the process smoother or the scheme more attractive?
Mr. Jain has explained the amendments made by the cabinet, which has still to be surfaced on the legislature. So now there is one area which can be taken care of, according to me. Taxes levied under Section 115 BBE on the additions made under Section 68, 69, which unexplained credits, unexplained investment, and all these things. So that tax has been enhanced from normal tax rate to 60% from assessment year 13, 14. So on that, there is surcharge of further 25%. So these are coming together with cess, it will come about 74% taxes. So if you are asking for taxes only, then it is very difficult for a person to pay on this addition tax about 78% of the
amount. Yeah.
So if they brought those also in the 30% bracket, which is maximum tax for another income, then more and more people will be attracted. So 115 BBE is also imposed by the tax authorities unnecessarily also in some very genuine cases where the deposit relates to their own sales, books have not been rejected, all these things. So this will further ease the process and many and more people will come under the scheme, which can raise the revenue for the government as well as peace of mind, as well as the burden of the courts where the appeals are pending.
Okay. And hopefully suggestions like these will be taken up when the bill gets discussed in Lok Sabha. Thank you, Mr. Jain. Thank you, Mr. Bansal, for joining us on the discussion. It is time for us to end the show. You can watch our shows on the RSTV page of YouTube. We will be back with a new issue and a new episode. Keep watching Rajya Sabha TV.